I've arrived in Dublin, a vibrant commercial, cultural, and political center of the Irish Republic. At the head of a beautiful bay, fanning out from the River Liffey, the city's population of 1.2 million is the youngest in Europe, with half of the people under the age of 25. The city's handsome Georgian buildings are a reminder of British rule, and in these streets, rebels battled for Irish independence. At Easter 1916, Irish rebels staged an uprising against British rule, using weapons supplied by Germany that was then at war with Britain. The British army crushed the insurgents with heavy casualties on both sides. And then 16 rebels were executed, which turned moderate Irish opinion against Britain. But one was spared because he was a citizen of the United States and Britain did not want to offend its ally. His name was Eamon de Valera. At Dublin Castle, once the seat of British power, I'm meeting his grandson, Eamon O'Queeve. He's followed de Valera into politics, serving as a member of the Dáil Éireann for his party Fianna Fáil.
Welcome to Dublin.
Thank you very much. Well, Dublin Castle is the scene of amazing events in Irish history.
I suppose the one that often captures the imagination is the handover of power in 1922 from the British to the Irish.
But your grandfather, Eamon de Valera, was not present at the handover.
He wasn't here. He had been president of the Republic up until January 1922, but he subsequently lost that position because of his opposition to the treaty. The provisions of the treaty had a few fairly unacceptable clauses to a lot of Irish people who had declared the Republic and set up their own government, including an oath of allegiance to the King.
And was it partly that the treaty accepted a division of Ireland between South and North?
Absolutely. And that was a major issue, but other reasons also. There wasn't internal freedom, or complete freedom, were also problems.
The rebels had declared an Irish Republic of which de Valera was president, but he refused to travel to London to negotiate with the British. A team that included the revolutionary hero Michael Collins signed the Anglo-Irish Treaty, which de Valera rejected. But he would become the most significant statesman in modern Irish history, becoming president in a ceremony in these grand state rooms.
After the treaty with the British and the civil war in Ireland, Ireland is part of the British Empire still, tied to the British crown. How can de Valera operate in that environment?
By 1932, he gets elected democratically into government here. He immediately sets about dismantling step by step the treaty. They abolish the oath of allegiance. And then in 1936, when King Edward VIII abdicated as King of England, he took advantage of that to totally take the king out of internal affairs in Ireland. A new constitution was brought in, gave power ultimately to the people, and instituted the office of President of Ireland as head of state.
When does de Valera become President of Ireland?
In 1959, and in fact, just up there, he was inaugurated as president. He served incredibly two terms, so he came here a second time in 1966, and he was president until 1973, when he retired at 90 years of age.
How do you assess, then, the impact of this enormous career on Ireland?
I think he left a huge mark in Ireland in giving the Irish people the constitution that we still have today, which is based on very democratic principles, the distributed wealth, the distributed land amongst the tenant farmers. So there were a lot of things started in the 30s and led to the prosperous Ireland that we enjoy today.